Everybody, welcome back to the 31 Days of Tarot, hosted by Essany. It is day 18, and today's topic is something that we learned about tarot in the last year. So share one new thing you learned about tarot in the last year. I have a couple of things, more than one. Tarot is like something you're always learning, and it's always growing and changing and evolving, which is really cool. So let me see. So just on a personal level, I guess, last year, I really knew nothing about shadow work, and a lot, now that I'm networking with a lot of other readers and following them online on various social media platforms, shadow work comes up a lot, and so I wanted to learn more, so I kind of dove into that and did a bit of personal shadow work and introspection using my cards and learning how to use cards to do some shadow work and some healing. And so I took courses. I took the Tarot Summer School with Essany, and I took Benable Wen's shadow work course. I've also been watching a lot of videos on YouTube and then doing my own journaling and exploration, and it's really interesting to see new insights that come out of the cards as I project my subconscious thoughts or pull things out of cards that kind of go beyond the traditional meaning. So that's been a really cool experience, is exploring, learning shadow work. Another thing I learned, of course. So last year I did some kind of free tutorials, online workshops, comparing tarot to the hero's journey. So I did a hero's journey Instagram challenge in September. I did a couple of workshops. You can, if you're interested, there is a video on my channel. I did it live, but the replay is there for you to watch anytime. It is, I believe, an hour plus long, maybe even an hour and a half. I can't remember. It's been a while since I did it. But that was just my own personal insight by learning about the hero's journey and what I know about tarot cards, and then looking at specifically the major arcana and comparing the cards there to the, what are they called? It was like 17 steps or pillars or something of the hero's journey. So comparing those themes that Joseph Campbell had identified in his monomyth and to the 22 major arcana. So I did kind of my own personal study, my own compare and contrast, and I learned a couple of things from that exercise and that study, particularly the Hermit. So one of Joseph Campbell's themes that come out of any myth or story is that there's often this wise wizard that meets the hero, offers them a tool that they can use on their journey, some spiritual message, a spiritual gift, and then sends them on their way. They're usually very cryptic. So we have wizards sometimes we have actual wizards like Dumbledore or Gandalf, but there's also usually some old man or wise person who comes along and says, kind of guides the hero. So like Obi-Wan Kenobi must be another example of one of these wizard characters that show up in stories quite a lot and offer some kind of divine wisdom or a gift or a tool, often a sword or a weapon that the hero will use on their journey. And so as you lay out the major arcana, that Hermit card comes up at just the right point in a story plot to be that wizard, that advisor who encourages the hero or the fool to step outside their comfort zone, go on an adventure, and provides them with some wisdom or a tool. So that was a neat take on the Hermit. And Temperance too. kind of, I feel like I know more about temperance now than maybe I did this time last year. The temperance card has evolved for me quite a bit. Because of that hero's journey study, I now see temperance as, well, I see first, let's start with, it comes right after the death card. So the death card, when we compare it to the hero's journey, to me, is that stepping, you're leaving the world you know, and you're entering a new world, an unknown world, outside of your comfort zone. And as you do that, you are allowing that old person to die so that you can become someone new. So it's that threshold, that you're crossing from one world into another. And that's often what heroes or fools will do, is they'll say goodbye to their family, everything that they've known, and step out into some unknown adventure. And so when they come back, they're not going to be the same person as they were when they left. And so that's the death card. And so temperance is that kind of calm before the storm, before things get scary, and frightening and ugly. They're still kind of exciting, and you can see the crown in a traditional, darn, I should have had been prepared, but if you look at a traditional Rider-Waite tarot card, there's a little path behind the angel that's pouring the cups back and forth, and there's a little crown hovering above that path. And so that's the boon, that's the treasure, that's waiting at the end of the adventure, guiding you along your path, along your journey. And so that was something new that stood out to me, as I was doing this study between the hero's journey and the fool's journey, basically. Yeah, so temperance was just kind of like, nothing's happened yet, but you are in uncharted territory now. It's sort of that, yeah, this kind of peaceful place, or this period before, the danger, the villains present themselves. What was another thing I learned? There was something else. Oh yeah, so at some point last year, I was looking at some of the major arcana cards, just kind of diving a little deeper for my own personal study. And I do remember the Lover's card, for whatever reason, like really sucked me in. There was all this stuff in the Lover's card that I didn't know about, or hadn't really thought about, or was unaware. And so as I'm learning other things, it kind of made me look at lovers a little bit differently. And so again, if you look at a traditional Rider-Waite Smith lover's card, you kind of see this Genesis image of Adam and Eve in front of the trees, the tree of knowledge, which grew the apples that got them kicked out of Eden, and you see the little serpent there. So it's very, very much the imagery from the biblical story, the Genesis story of Adam and Eve. And that seems quite obvious, and that wasn't new to me, but there's another tree in there. And I was like, okay, well, that's obviously the tree of knowledge, but what is that other tree? And so the pictorial key, I believe, the pictorial key says that it is the tree of life. And so I went to my Bible, and I'm rereading Genesis to try to figure out, okay, well, what is the meaning behind the tree of life? And it has very little mention. Like, it is in there, but it's not explained. It's just kind of like, yeah, here's this garden, and in it grows a tree of knowledge and a tree of life. And you don't really hear much about the tree of life, or the tree of immortal life. You hear only about the tree of knowledge, because that was the one that they ate the fruit from and got them kicked out of Eden. And then I was watching, no, I was listening, reading all of the above, because I think I've done it in almost every format now. I'm a big fan of Joseph Campbell, no secrets there. And I believe it's The Power of Myth. So it was his interview, Bill Moyers. And Bill Moyers and Joseph Campbell sit down for this very lengthy interview, and it's all recorded and documented. You can read it in a book, their whole conversation. You could watch it on film, or listen to it on as like a radio or audiobook. And it's quite fascinating. And there was a part in there where Campbell references the Tree of Life and the Tree of Knowledge. And we all know that the Tree of Knowledge kind of gives you this new sense of seeing the world. And when they ate the fruit from that tree, Adam and Eve started to notice dualities, opposites, the difference between man and woman, the difference between guilt and or shame and innocence. There was a lot of knowledge and opposites that came to them, the difference between man and God, the difference between life and death. I don't know, there was all these things that they just suddenly came to know. They became ashamed of their nudity, of their nakedness. They felt they had to cover up, and so that God was like, I see what you did there. You broke the rules, get out. And so Campbell says that to get to be to leave your ticket out of the Garden of Eden is to eat from the tree of the fruit from the Tree of Knowledge. But if you want back in, you eat from the fruit of the Tree of Immortal Life. And so he goes on to explain philosophies in Christianity as well as Buddhist philosophies, that the more that you experience life, pain and sorrow, and the goal is to realize through life, through experience, that dualities are more like polarities, that they are one. They are not different, they are not separating, they are not dividing, because that's what knowledge does. It starts to you start to categorize things, you start to put things in boxes, and you start creating division and separation. But the Tree of Life creates unity and brings things together, and you start to realize that, you know, you and I are not separate, we are one, we are part of a whole. Whether you want to talk about consciousness, just life on this planet, we are one. God and man are one. There is unity, there is no division, there is no separation. And so once you realize that, or you accept that, both in, so if we look at Buddhist tradition, that would you reach transcendence or nirvana. Once you can fully understand that you are not a separate being or a separate entity from anything else, you are part of one, you are part of a whole. And in Christianity, it would be that realization. So if you eat from that fruit of life, you have unity, you have wholeness, you understand that you and God are not different, you are the same, that you and other people, you and the animals, you and nature are one. And so I thought that just put a whole other perspective onto the Lover's card for me. So I found that kind of fascinating. And so it does illustrate choice. It does illustrate that, you know, if you think of the traditional meaning of the Lovers, it's about choices. It's about sacrifices and gains. And sacrifices and gains, loss and gain, are not separate. They are the same. You can't gain something without losing something else, and vice versa. So, for example, you know, I think the easiest illustration to understand that is, say, you know, you have a house full of stuff. It's just full of stuff. Most of that stuff you don't even use. So let's say you get rid of the stuff. You're purging your home of objects that you no longer need. You're getting, that's a loss, that's a sacrifice, that's something you are losing. But as you do that, you gain extra space, you have more storage, you have more space for other things. So you have this simultaneous loss and gain, and that happens all the time. So when you gain a spouse, let's just look at the Lovers, you are committing to that person, you have a gain. You have gained somebody's trust, somebody's love, somebody's commitment, and you are sacrificing the joys or experiences of being single. So, and if you sacrifice your partner, you gain the benefits of being single. So there's always this kind of tug, I guess, and finding the right balance at the time. So, yeah, I felt like I understand the lovers a lot better. What I don't understand still, the one thing about that card that still confuses me, is the angel. There's always that third party in the tarot with the lovers. It's never, or very rarely, just two lovers. There's often like a third being or individual there. And I was wondering, like, who is this angel? And when I'm doing a lot of research, a lot of people seem to agree, for I don't know why, I don't know where this origin came from, because it wasn't in the pictorial key written by Waite. They say it's Raphael, the angel Raphael. Well, Raphael is the angel of healing and health, and I don't know why that would show up in a lover's card. I don't know. Does anybody... feel free. I would love, if you guys have insight, please tell me, because that just baffles me. I know some people said, oh, I always thought it was like Cupid or Eros, which makes a lot more sense. But then Cupid and Eros are not part of Genesis. They're not part of that Christian mythology, whereas Raphael would be. But why Raphael? I don't know. I'm very confused by that. So that is a question I am putting out there to you guys. If you can shed any light on that or know the history behind that angel, please let me know, because that would be very interesting to me. So I think that sums up my biggest lessons. I mean, there's so many things I learned. I mean, I'm sure I've learned a lot more. It's just kind of like you have these epiphany moments or these new insights, and you're like, oh, and then, you know, you kind of just incorporate it, and it kind of just fits in with what you already know, and you just kind of dovetail it in your knowledge, and you kind of forget that that was a new thing that you just added to your already, you know, Rolodex of information that you have in your brain. So I'm sure there's a lot more, but those are just some of the things that stand out to me. And this video is way longer than I meant it to be, so I'm going to wrap it up here, and I'll be back tomorrow for day 19. Until then, guys, stay shiny and keep sparkling.